about resilience. What is resilience? Resilience is your ability to get back from a crisis that you're facing. So can we say that just like a phoenix that comes out from ashes, resilience is our ability to get back from a setback that we have faced.
Right.
So what are a few examples of resilience? Maybe you're working, you've been given a task, and you don't do it as well as you expected it. And then resilience is what comes to you when you get back to the task and start working on it again. Why do we need resilience? I think that human civilization has gone ahead only because of resilience. We have faced many crises, and then because of resilience, we have got back. And this is also applicable on a personal level. So resilience is in human nature. It is because we need to continuously grow and find new opportunities even if we face certain challenges. But yet, we face sometimes a lack of resilience in ourselves. What can we do to improve our resilience?
Rightly pointed out by Ovi, in terms of the nature of human civilization, it has been thriving through centuries of ups and downs. And every time it has fallen, we have been showing an innate quality, an innate nature of bouncing back with vigor and vitality. So how do we do that? How humans have got that capacity to bounce back again? Mind you, the key here is how you are able to channelize your emotions. And how are you able to channelize your mind in totality? If you are able to have that control over your mental function,
right,
most of your challenges, most of the crises, you are easily able to overcome. So let's talk about a small technique. This technique from the oriental repository of, you know, humankind, from this part of the world that the world has been recognizing over a period of time, this age-old technique that we want to talk about is about breathing.
Okay.
And breathing is one such thing that is phenomenally applicable in various levels of human upliftment. The basic of it is required for us to live a life.
Okay.
Now let us focus why breathing and why how it is related to mind. Coming from the ancient wisdom, mind and prana are equally placed in our existence.
Yeah.
If one is disturbed, the other is disturbed. If there is a derangement in prana, there is derangement in mind. If there is derangement in mind, there is derangement in prana. So you balance one, you will have control over other.
Right.
Now you'll ask how does that work? The best part to channelize your prana or have a control over your prana is through your breathing.
Right.
You do that and you'll find that your mind is stable.
The simplest method.
How do you do that and how it impacts your resilience? So let us understand first the technique. We'll practice it.
Yes.
We'll try to do it. Most part of the world it is called pranayama because it has been put in lot of texts. The text that we have been finding in Ayurveda or pranic healing. But let us understand the psychobiology behind it. And then it is very useful to put it in practice for everybody.
Yeah.
So the psychobiology behind it is, it's like a mental gym.
Hmm.
So every time you go out in your gymnasium, you try and do a lot of exercises, repetitions of particular exercises to strengthen your muscles. The frequent repetitions that you do, more the muscles get the strength and flexibility.
Practice makes perfect.
Absolutely. In that context, breathing applies to the same principle. It makes sure that after every consistent effort to stabilize your breath, to have a pattern, to have a disciplined way of breathing, will make sure that your mind has a greater control over your emotions and your expression of emotions. So while there are patterns of breathing that are practiced in Ayurveda or maybe holistic healthcare practices, these have immense benefit, physical and mental, for humankind. One of that methods, as I said, is pranayama.
Okay.
So let's do it.
Yes.
You, most of you across length and breadth of India has been doing it in the entire world, in Europe, in maybe United States. There is a wave of, you know, renewed rejuvenation for the need, and the need is felt to practice yoga and pranayama.
Correct.
So a simplest way is that we do is having taking in the breath, holding it for a moment, and leaving it out. And one such cycle of complete taking in and taking breathing out completes one repetition. So you do these 3, 4, 5, 10 repetitions a day, and you'll find that most of the time, at a time in a day, we'll find that most of the things will start coming to you in terms of your mind control. You need a consistent practice for a considerable period of time, at least 3 weeks, 4 weeks practice.
Yeah.
Should we do it?
Yes, let's
yes,
do it.
Yes. So sit straight. You just have to hold, take help of your fingers, and it's in a classical way. One nostril, we put a thumb on your one of the nostrils. The other nostril that is open, you breathe in, take a deep breath, hold with 2 fingers, with the first nostril you exhale, and then hold, again from the first nostril, breathe in. Hold, and from the second nostril, breathe out. This is the classical way of doing it. Even in the entire research, it has been found that this has helped a lot of immense thousands of people to bounce back. In India, we find this is significantly practiced all over, whether it is villages or towns or maybe urban areas. It drives through the cultural vein of Indian population. Let me tell you, this builds in a very strong circuitry in your brain, which is innately present, as we have said it earlier, the resilient nature of humankind.
Yes.
When we practice this for some period of time, like 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, you'll find that you have the strength, the mental immunity, the mental capacity to come back with a lot of vigor and vitality.
Yes.
We hope that you'll be able to practice this method, a simple method, to make yourself resilient in the challenging times that we are facing. Thank you.